Romans chapter 11. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. For I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people, whom he foreknew. Do you not know what the scripture says of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets, they have demolished your altars, and I alone am left, and they seek my life. But what is God's reply to him? I have kept myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant, chosen by grace. But if it is by grace, it is no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace. What then? Israel failed to obtain what it was seeking? The elect obtained it, but the rest were hardened, as it is written. God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that would not see, and ears that would not hear, down to this very day. And David says, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. Let their eyes be darkened so they cannot see, and bend their backs forever. So I ask, did they stumble in order that they might fall? By no means. Rather, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles, so as to make Israel jealous. Now if their trespass means riches for the world, and if their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? Now I am speaking to you Gentiles, inasmuch then as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry, in order that somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous, and thus save some of them. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? If the dough offered as first fruits is holy, so is the whole lump. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. But if some of the branches were broken off, and you, although a wild olive tree, were grafted among the others, and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree, do not be arrogant toward the branches. If you are, remember it is not you who support the root, but the root that supports you. Then you will say, branches were broken off so that I might be grafted in. That is true. They were broken off because of their unbelief, but you stand fast through faith. So do not become proud, but fear. For if God did not spare the natural branches, neither will he spare you. Note then the kindness and the severity of God, severity towards those who have fallen, but God's kindness to you, provided you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off, and even they, if they do not continue in their unbelief, will be grafted in. For God has the power to graft them in again. For if you were cut from what is by nature a wild olive tree and grafted contrary to nature into a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these, the natural branches, be grafted back into their own olive tree? Lest you be wise in your own sight, I do not want you to be unaware of this mystery, brothers. A partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And in this way, all Israel will be saved, as it is written. The deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob. And this will be my covenant with them when I take away their sins. As regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake. But as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. For just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they too have now been disobedient in order that by mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. For God has consigned all to disobedience that he may have mercy on all. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen.
We've been moving week by week in a sermon series through the book of Romans, and we come to chapters 9 and 10 and 11. 2 weeks ago, 9, last week, 10, this week, 11. And in this, the Apostle Paul is raising the question, why are there so many Jewish people who have rejected their Messiah, Jesus? What does this have to do with God's plan for salvation? If we were to briefly think about what we saw in chapter 9, the Apostle Paul had said, does this all mean that God failed in some way? He says, no, this isn't a failure of God. This is actually part of God's plan. And then he comes to chapter 10, and he says, it still is, chapter 10, verse 1, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites, that they might be saved. That they might be saved. He says, I'm an Israelite. I care about my Israelite brethren. I want them to be saved. I'm praying for this end. And in fact, I am busy spending my time preaching the gospel to bring them this message, because all of us who are saved have the purpose of bringing salvation to others. He talks about how we ourselves are messengers. We ourselves are instruments that God uses to bring the gospel to other people. And he elaborated this in chapter 10. And now we come to chapter 11. And he asks the question at the beginning of this. He says, did God reject his people? Maybe somebody might think, oh, I get it. God took those Jewish people that he had worked with for so long, and then he just rejected them. Is that what he did? And he answers this question for us in chapter 11. And he gives us a little more understanding of how God has a great eternal outworking of his plan of how he is working with people. We're going to take this message in four parts. We're going to talk about a godly remnant, about a chain of blessing, about the doxology, about the analogy of a tree, and finally about the mystery of God's plan. Starting with a godly remnant here in verse 1, he says, I ask then, did God reject his people? And he immediately gives an answer. Did God reject his people? By no means. Anyone who thinks, well, I get it, God had his dealing with the Jewish people, and then he just completely turned away from them, and he has no more dealings with them, he says, no, that's not true. That's not true. And he begins to give four different reasons that this is not true. The first of them is his own personal reason. He says, I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham, from the tribe of Benjamin. He says, one reason I know God didn't reject Israel is because he called me. When he wanted there to be a messenger who would be his apostle, bringing the message to all of the Gentiles around the world, he chose a Jewish man, namely Paul. He has purpose for the Israelites. And then a second reason. Verse 2, God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Whom he foreknew. You see, God already knew his people, and he divinely chose them. That divine choosing is all through the Bible. It's described all through it as God chose these. These were his chosen people, and that's incompatible with him rejecting these people. And then there's an historical reason, and that brings us to the next verse. Don't you know, I'm in the second half of verse 2, don't you know that the scripture says in the passage about Elijah, how he appealed to God against Israel. Lord, they have killed your prophets and tore down your altars, and I'm the only one left, and they're trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to you? I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. He's remembering a time many, many, many hundreds of years earlier when Elijah, the great prophet, said, I am the only one left. There's nobody else left serving you. All of Israel has completely been turned away from you. And God said, that's not true. I have some thousands who have not bowed the knee to the idols and instead served me. There was a remnant then of Israel that was faithful to God. Do you understand this so far? At that time, there was a remnant that was faithful to God. And as Paul points out in the next verse, there has always been such a remnant. And so he can say, In the very next verse, so too at the present time, there's a remnant chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it is no longer by works. If it were, that grace would no longer be grace. What is Paul telling us here? He says, in Elijah's day, there were thousands who belonged to God. In Paul's day, there were thousands who belonged to God, thousands of Jews. Today, in our day, there are thousands of Israelites, thousands of Jews who belong to God. They were chosen by God. God poured his grace out over them. It's not something that they themselves did. It's something God did to make this happen. And if God is busy doing that, if God is pouring out his grace on these different ones, then we can be sure that God is not rejecting the Jewish people. Did you understand this so far? We're just walking through Paul's line of reasoning. So then, at the present time, some of Israel is drawn to Christ as a holy remnant. Yes, the rest remains hardened, spiritually darkened, and that's no surprise to God. God isn't saying, oh wow, I can't believe these people aren't turning to me. God knows that this is happening. In fact, before that, God knew it would happen. God spoke of such things in the past, and that's where we get these quotes, starting in verses 7, 8, and 9. What then? What Israel sought so earnestly did not obtain, but the elect did. The others were hardened, as it is written. And he begins to quote about these things. The first of these quotes is as follows. God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes so they could not see, and ears so that they could not hear to this very day. Notice what's going on here. Rather than God saying, I can't believe it. I sent my son to be the Messiah, and they rejected him. I had no idea that would happen. Instead, God says, I predicted hundreds of years earlier that my Messiah would come, and they would have a spirit of darkness and hardness. And I knew that this was going to happen. The next quote we look at is in verses 10 and in verses 9 and 10. David says of them, is going back 1,000 years before Christ, King David wrote, may their table, that is their wealth, their security, their family, their religion, become for them a snare and a trap. They will stumble about in a blinded manner, loaded down with sin and spiritual sorrow, causing their backs to be bent. Again, Israel has rejected God, and God gave most of them for a time over to spiritual darkness. But God has not rejected Israel. This is something that is very, very plain to the Apostle Paul. So he can say there was a godly remnant. There is in his day a godly remnant. There will be a godly remnant of Jewish people. God has done this throughout all of human history. And now we get to another question. We get to a question now in verse 11. Again, I ask, did they stumble so as to fall beyond recovery? Someone might say, oh, I get it. The Jewish people, the Israelite nation, these folks stumbled so far that they are no longer able to be recovered and brought back to a place that would please God. Did they stumble so far as to be beyond recovery? And Paul's answer in this case is, not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. Let me see if I can explain this. He says, what God has done is he has allowed the Jews to be turning away from the Messiah Jesus in large numbers. Obviously not all Jews. The apostles themselves were Jews. Many of the early Christians were Jews. But in general, the Jewish nation hardened and began to bring persecution against the followers of Christ. Now, what was interesting is that the Gentiles began to come in large numbers to be Christians. People who were non-Jewish became Christians in huge numbers. And he says, God allowed this so that they might become envious. You see, envious in what way? Let me give you an illustration. Those of you who are parents will understand this. You've got a child, and that child says something like, I don't like math. I don't want to do my math, and this sort of thing. And you're doing something in multiplication table or some other thing. This one is hardened in rejecting multiplication. And then little brother comes along. And little brother says, oh, I like this. I can do this. And little brother feels like, wouldn't this be great? I can get ahead of big brother by knowing these tables even better. What does big brother do? He memorizes those even better. Yeah, no little brother's going to catch up with him. Do you understand this? This is human nature. Human nature does not want to be shown up by another. And so Paul says, in some way, there is a stirring that is being allowed in the hearts of the Jews who were the bigger brother, who had the gospel first and who knew God for many thousands of years, and they began to be hardened, and then the little brother began to grow in this, and God says, I'm going to allow that to one day stir them to a kind of jealousy, and at the right time, when I say is the right moment, they are going to not just have a remnant, a few who respond to me, but they will come in some numbers, and we'll get to that later on in this text. It says, rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. But if their transgression means riches for the world, that is to say, if the rejection of the Jews brings something good for the rest of the world, that is the rejection of the Jews toward Christ, and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their fullness bring? He's talking about a chain of blessing. I'm going to map this out for you. On the far left, Israel transgresses. Israel rejects the Lord. He says, well, that led to something good. God is the kind of God, I'll just say something real quickly here. God is the kind of God who can take everything that seems bad and make it good for those who trust him and are walking according to his plan. Did you understand that? God can do that. And so there are Israelites who transgress, reject the Lord, and he says, I'm turning that to something good. I planned and knew this ahead of time. I'm going to bring Gentile salvation as a result. And as a result of that, the next step in this chain is that Israel becomes envious and says, what they have, you know, that should have been rightly ours, their faith, their adherence to the scriptures and so forth. Israel becomes envious. And then he says, what's going to happen is that in the right time, it's going to bring about salvation to Israel in greater numbers, to a larger degree than we've ever seen before, even than what I think we have yet seen. And when that happens, it will bring even a greater blessing for the rest of the world. If Israel, through its sin and rejection of Christ, could bring blessing to the world, then through its receiving of Christ one day, it will bring even greater blessing. Do you understand all this? One link of the chain after another brings all of these things. And so Paul says, I'm gladly working to promote the salvation of the Jews, in part by sharing with them, but mostly by sharing with the Gentiles and stirring up the Jews to have a desire to hear more about this. When Paul would go from city to city, he'd preach to the Gentiles there about these matters that were rooted in the Jewish scriptures. It was not uncommon for Jewish authorities to grab a hold of him and say, what are you telling these people? What's going on with this? And they would be interested to know because of what he was doing amongst the Gentiles. He said, I'm going to keep doing that. Let's see what the text says. He says, I am talking to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles. I make much of my ministry in the hope that I may somehow arouse my own people in envy and save some of them. He says, I am doing this. I am sharing this with the Gentiles, and I'm arousing my own people as I do this. For if their rejection is the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? When they finally, in great numbers, turn to the Lord, watch out, this is going to be really good. And then he gives two more analogies. If part of the dough offered as first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy, so are the branches. What's he talking about in these things? Well, the first of these analogies, he says, you all know that in the Old Testament, it gives the impression that if some of the dough is given over to be used for holy purposes in the temple, well, then all of the dough has to be regarded as holy. You don't have some of it for holy things and some of it for unholy. And he's trying to say, going all the way back to the patriarchs, all the way back to the ancient things of the Jewish nation, God said, you are a holy people, I'm setting you aside. He says, if part of it has been set aside this way, then in some respect, all of it, down to the very end, is something that God regards as special and holy. The Israelite people are regarded by God in a special and unique way from the start to the finish. And he gives the same kind of a thing. He says, if the roots are holy, well, then the whole plant is holy. If you have a plant and part of it is set aside to God, all of it is set aside to God. If you have a nation and God started it at its root as being something that was unique and special to him, then it remains so through the rest of its life. If some of the branches have been broken off, and you, the wild olive shoot, have been grafted in among the others and now share the nourishing sap from the olive root, do not boast over those branches. If you do, consider this. You do not support the root, but the root supports you. Let's think for a moment about what the apostle is telling us here in this set of verses. He's moving on to what I would call an analogy of a tree. This is the third part of our message. How do we as Gentiles fit together with the people of Israel in regard to God's larger plan of salvation? Some people erroneously thought, oh, I see, God had one plan for saving Israel, and then God had this completely other plan for saving people who are not of Israel. And the way he saves those who are not of Israel is through the New Testament church, through faith in Christ, and he has something different for the nation of Israel, and it's all kind of two different things. That's not true. The Apostle Paul says, no, in fact, what it is what God has done is he had an original plan. He planted something like a tree, and that was Israel, and he put down good roots and started to grow. And then some of those branches in that tree were unproductive. Some of them were not doing what they were supposed to do, and God lopped those branches off, and he grafted in other branches. Some of you know what grafting in means, some of you might not. This is not something I personally have a lot of experience with, but as I understand it, you can take a tree, and you can make a little slit in that tree, a little slice in it, and you can take a branch that comes from a different tree, and provided there's a close enough match somehow, you can put that branch into the spot where you've made a little slice, and then you can wrap something that looks like a big bandage around it all, and in time, the host tree accepts this new limb as a part of the tree and sends its life-giving sap out to that branch and it begins to produce something. Is everybody with me on this so far? All right then. Here he says to us, you Gentiles, you are like branches that have been grafted in. Here we have an olive tree in the upper right, and he speaks of an olive tree. The reason he speaks of an olive tree in this text is because the olive tree represented Israel. It was one of the key symbols for Israel, the same way that we think of our nation being represented by something. Sometimes you see a picture of a great eagle and you know it's meant to represent America, or you see a picture of Uncle Sam and you know that's meant to represent America. The olive tree represented Israel. And he said, this olive tree that was Israel had branches that were grafted in, and you see on the left, something where on the front, that left with a kind of drawing of hands putting something around a tree. I think it's trying to show that it's grafting in. That little branch that's on the lower left there is what that's trying to show us. He says, we Gentiles fit together with the people of Israel in regards to God's larger plan in this way. We are an olive tree. We are the branches grafted into this olive tree. And that some branches had been removed. Some branches of Israel that were faithless were removed to make room for us. If some of the branches had been broken off, as we read here in verse 17, and you, the wild olive shoot, not part of the original tree, have been grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing sap of your olive root, do not boast over those branches. If you do, consider this. You don't support the root supports you. You didn't start this thing. God started with Israel. It's you being grafted in. You will say then branches were broken off so I could be grafted in. Granted, that's true. But they were broken off because of unbelief. And you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but be afraid. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. The idea here is that some branches, faithless Jews, have been broken off, but you, believing Gentiles, have been grafted in. Both the wild and the domestic branches share in the life-giving sap of the original tree. There is a beauty in our connection to all this, and I need you to stop and think about this for a moment. The God of the Bible, the great God of Israel, is the God who knows and loves and protects his people who are not Jews, but are Gentiles who are grafted in. You understand this? The scriptures, the Old Testament scriptures, are ours to know and love. the history of those patriarchs and others become our history. We have been grafted in. Perhaps I can say it this way. This is a small analogy, and maybe it will help you understand. Virtually everyone in this room goes back to a time when your family was not an American family. And you have stories of how your family at one time or another came to this land and were, so to speak, mixed in, melded in, grafted into this land, this country, this nation. Do you understand this? And all of you can then say, in some ways, your history can go back to certain founders, whether Washington or even earlier than that, to people like Bradford and others, because of what God started, that became your history because you were brought into this land. Do you understand this? That is a little bit of something you can all understand. Yep, I got that. That's kind of our nation's history, our heritage. That's my heritage, you would say. He says, if you are believers, if you are Christians, your history, your heritage, goes all the way back to the Old Testament and the patriarchs and so on. You have been grafted in, brought into this place of the faith of the Jewish people. Now, he gives a warning in this as well. He says, though that's happened, and that's good, I don't want you to get proud about this. What so often happens, listen, church, the group of people will say, well, obviously, we're now part of this church, we're now part of this Christian family, we're doing just wonderful. There's no need to really have personal faith in Christ and live for God from generation to generation. We're just automatically now part of God's family. And he says, watch it. If God was willing to trim off Jewish branches that weren't producing, how much more will he gladly trim off you if you don't have genuine faith? Did you understand that warning? That is a warning from God. I think Mr. Winter's testimony was helpful. He said that he grew up in a religious setting, grew up in a church-going setting, and didn't know Jesus Christ as Savior. God is not looking for those who will go to church. He's not looking for those who claim some heritage. He's looking for those who have a personal, real, saving faith in Jesus Christ. Do you get this? Young people, not one of you can say, oh, I'm doing great. Mom and dad are believers. I go to church. Everything's cool. He says, I will gladly trim you off of this tree just as fast or faster than I trimmed Jewish people off of that tree, because they at least had that long-standing covenant that I made with Abraham, and you didn't have that. I grafted Gentiles in, provided that they did this in faith through belief in Christ. And he says, watch out for all of this. He gives this word of warning. He tells us here in verse 22, consider therefore the kindness and sternness of God. He wants us to consider the kindness and sternness or the kindness and severity of God. God is such a wonderful God, so loving in bringing us in, and is so full of righteous judgment and sternness in cutting off those who will not believe. God is both. Consider both of these things. He gives us this one. Consider therefore the kindness and sternness of God. Sternness to those who fell, but kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you also will be cut off. And if they do not persist in unbelief, then they will be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. That is to say, the same God who saw the Jewish folks cut off from this, he says, he can easily graft them back in again. In fact, there's a promise later on that he will, in large numbers, be grafting them. He says, this is no difficulty for God. After all, if you were cut off, if you were cut out of an olive tree that was wild by nature, and continued and contrary to nature were grafted into a cultivated olive tree, how much more readily would those, the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? What are we saying here? If you take something that isn't a really good match and try to graft it in, it's kind of a miracle if it gets grafted in, if it's from a wild tree that wouldn't normally fit. And he says, for you as a Gentile to be grafted into God's olive tree of the family of faith, that's a real miracle if that happens. For you, But if a Jewish person who has been lopped off, trimmed off, and so forth later on, if God wants to bring large numbers of Jewish people and bring them back in, he says that's not as difficult. It's no difficulty for God to do that, first because he's God, and secondly, they are an identical match to the original tree. He says that's not trouble for God. And that brings us to the last of our parts. We've talked about a godly remnant and this chain of blessing. And then an analogy of a tree, which we've been listening to. And finally, we want to hear something about the mystery of God's plan. I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers. Verse 25. What is a mystery? A mystery to you and me is something where we don't know the end of it all. But a mystery in the Bible is something where we don't really quite understand the depth of God's purpose. There's a part of it that seems too difficult for us to understand for those who are uninitiated. They don't quite grasp it all. And he says, I don't want you to be ignorant of this mystery, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening, in part, until the full number of the Gentiles is coming. He says, I'm going to tell you a mystery. And the mystery is that God has a plan. And the mystery is that God, in his plan, decided that he would cause the Jewish people to largely have cold and hard hearts toward this, until something happens that he says is the full number of the Gentiles comes in, and then one, he's going to do something to bring in large numbers of Jewish people in. Did you all understand this? He says there's a full number of Gentiles to come in. And something where God, I almost picture God with one of these little counter thingies, you know, quickly, where you count people up. And he says, I am waiting until I've got the full number of those that I have chosen. Click. And when that full number comes in, and I don't know what that number is, and I don't know when that will take place. But when the full number comes in, he says, then there is going to be a harvest among the Jews. I don't want you to be ignorant, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full number of Gentiles comes in. And so all Israel will be saved. That is to say, after there will be the full number of Gentiles coming in, there is going to be a widespread saving of Israel, as it is written. Here he quotes again from the Old Testament, and the quote goes as follows. The deliverer will come from Zion. I am here in verse 26. The deliverer will come from Zion. He will turn godlessness away from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. He says there will come a moment when the Lord himself will arrive in power to his people, to Jacob's descendants, that is to Israel, and he will in large measure see them forgiven of their sins because of their faith in Christ. As far as the gospel is concerned, they are enemies on your account. What is this saying? When Gentile people would begin to preach the gospel and say, Jesus is the Messiah, and look at the scriptures, and this is the truth, Jewish people in Paul's day would sometimes oppose this, sometimes viciously oppose it, and become enemies of Christians. So, concerning the gospel, they are enemies on your account. But as far as election is concerned, they are loved on account of the patriarch. He says, even though they act like your enemies, love them anyway, because it was through the Jewish people that, through the patriarchs, and through the writers of the Old Testament, and through the line of Messiah, and through Jesus, who was a Jewish person, God brought all of this to you, and you are to have a tremendous love for the Jewish people, because even if they oppose what's going on in your faith, you are to have a great love for them. Did you understand this? I will tell you this. This is just a simple word for all of you. When people grow as Christians, God puts a love in their heart for everyone. You don't have the option of being enemies or being angry with others. And he puts a great love in your heart for Jewish people. And there's a sense that you have that God has had a powerful relationship and love with Jewish people going all the way back to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and that he has you to have a heartfelt cry for him to finish that work that he has done amongst the Jewish people. He says, they are loved by you. You are to love them on account of the patriarchs. For God's gifts and his call are irrevocable. What God did in his covenants with the Jewish people, those things are irrevocable. They can't be undone. God started this, and he's going to finish it. Just as you, who were one time disobedient to God, now receive mercy as a result of their disobedience. In other words, you were full of disobedience, and God poured out mercy on you. So they, too, have become disobedient in order that they may now receive mercy as a result of God's mercy to you. The key words here are disobedience and mercy. He says, I want to tell you, you as Gentiles, you are so disobedient, God poured out his mercy on you. The Jewish people have been so disobedient, God's going to pour out his mercy and blessing on them. For God has bound all men over to disobedience so that he may have mercy on them all. He has a plan where he is going to make sure that people of every race, every tribe, every tongue, people of every background, Gentile groups and the Jews, are going to be his. There are going to be people from every group represented. And then Paul, thinking about all of this, does something very interesting. He doesn't say, wow, this is confusing and upsetting and so on. He says instead, wow, this is wonderful. God has an eternal plan. God is working this out. Everything we see around us, the opposition of the Jews toward Paul, the opposition of the Jews toward those who spread the gospel, the troubles that there have been in this world, all of the things that have been going on that have been outworked in a way that is, you know, a challenge. He says, this is really all God's work. He's doing a great work. And in fact, he says, I want to give a word of praise to God. It's really a doxology to God. Let's see if we can find this. There's the doxology. Oh, he says, the depth and the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Oh, he says here in verse 33, there is a depth of God's wisdom and knowledge. He is doing something that's beyond our understanding. He is working behind the scenes to bring the Gentiles to Christ, and then he will work still later to bring Jews to him. He's doing all of this. How unsearchable his judgments, his paths beyond tracing out. He does things beyond our understanding. Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? Or from him, and through him, and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. These are words that Paul concludes this with. Now, I want to say something to you. We've been going through chapters 9 and 10 and 11, and it's been so much about what God has done, the work that God has done in choosing certain ones and working behind the scenes and fulfilling his gospel purposes. And I want to give us at least 5 lessons that we can learn from Romans 9 and 11. There probably are many more than these 5, but here are 5 key things that we can understand from Paul's teaching in these 3 chapters. The first of them is this. The current state of the world is no accident. It is part of God's larger plan. You understand this. The Apostle Paul could say, there are many, many, many Jews who are rejecting Jesus right now. There are troubles with Jewish people oppressing Jews who become Christians, Christians who are using Jewish scriptures. There's trouble with the Roman Empire opposing us. There's things all going on that are really, really bad right now. And he says, no, this is okay. God is in charge of this world. He knows what's going on, and he's going to fulfill his purposes. You follow me on this so far? That same principle applies today. This is one of the reasons why I don't get very worried or upset when I hear news from day to day. I hear about, you know, asteroids that are going to blow up the world, and I hear about global warming, and it's going to be the end of the polar bears, and I hear about, you know, oil prices that are going to rise so we can't get our homes anymore, and I hear about, oh, terrorist groups that are on the march, and I hear about elections that go in ways that you never would have wished they'd go. Do you know what I'm talking about? And I think some of this is the result of sin, and some of this is really, really bad at one level, but there's something greater than all of that, and that is God. And he has a purpose and a plan for this world, and his purposes will be fulfilled. There is nothing that people can do, whether it's terrorists or corrupt governments or even asteroids that want to blow up the world. None of these things can do anything except by God's permission. And he's already told us what he intends to do with this world in terms of there's going to be a harvest amongst the Gentiles, and there's going to be this harvest amongst the Jews, and there's going to be the return of Christ, there's going to be all these things that happen. And I don't spend time worrying at night about what's going to happen because it's all in God's hands. He is divinely in charge. And something of this is what Paul is expressing. He says everything that's happening right now around him in his ministry, and even the things that are opposing his ministry, are all part of what is permanent in God's hand. The second thing, God's sovereignty, that is, he's in charge, and human choice. In the last couple of chapters, especially chapters 9 and 10, there was an awful lot about how God had his sovereignty and his divine election, and also things about choice and about people being responsible for what they were doing and hardening themselves. God's sovereignty and human choice appear to be opposed to one another. In other words, people would say, well, which is it? Either God chose to do this or people are doing this. Which is it? They may appear to be opposed to one another, but like gears in a machine, they work toward a definite result. We used this analogy a couple weeks ago. You can stand and look at a great machine that has moving parts, and one part is moving in a clockwise direction, and the gear right next to it is moving in a counterclockwise direction, and you look at one of them and you're sure that everything's moving this way, and you look at the other and you're equally sure it's all moving that way because the two of them are constantly going in opposite direction to each other. But then you see that something goes in this end of the machine and comes out this end of the machine as a finished product. And in something like the same way, God says, I'm the one who elects these things. I have divinely foreknown this. I'm the one who's in charge. I'm sovereign. And he says, you are required to make this decision and obey me and trust me and have faith. And they both work together in ways that are mysterious beyond our understanding how those two work together, and they do. And anyone who is going to negate one of these and say, well, it's not really God's sovereignty, that would be sort of embarrassing, or it's not really people's responsibility because that wouldn't give enough of God's divine control. It is both, and the Bible speaks of both. The Bible does. They are both working together. And I don't want us to negate either one of them. There is, and this is the third thing we learn, there is only one way of salvation, and that is through Jesus Christ. Notice this. There are not two trees, the olive tree and the Jews are saved one way, and then some other tree, a birch tree, and the Gentiles are saved some other way. How many trees were there? There was one tree. And people from all groups were grafted into how many trees? One tree. Because how many ways of salvation are there? One. There's one way of salvation, and that way is through Jesus Christ. This is something that's very clear from these chapters in Romans. A couple more lessons. Evangelism is absolutely necessary, for it's God's tool for pricking hearts with the truth of salvation through Jesus Christ. So much of chapter 10 was all about that, as the Apostle Paul would say, I am using this message, I'm bringing this message. In fact, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news, and how will anyone hear and know and respond unless it is that somebody goes and tells? Do you remember all of this from last chapter? Christian friends, if you know Jesus Christ as Savior, if you know Him, you have one primary purpose in this world, while you're still here in this world, and that is to bring the message of the gospel to others. Otherwise, you may as well be saved and then go immediately to heaven because you have no other purpose here. The only thing that you cannot do in heaven, the only thing you really, really cannot do in heaven and do any of you, is you cannot share Christ with unbelievers because they're not there. The one thing that you can do that will be useful in this lifetime is to share the message of the gospel with those who have not yet heard. And that's something that is essential to these chapters 9 and 10 and 11 of the book of Romans. And our last thing that we're going to point out, a lesson from Romans 9 through 11, God has never ridden Israel out of his plans. When the full number of Gentiles come in, God will initiate a widespread restoration of the Jews for his glory. That seems to be Paul's strong implication, especially in the latter half of this chapter. He says, God is working until the fullness of the Gentiles come in, the full number of Gentiles come in, and then there will be a redemption and a saving power that will happen for the Jews. And he says, that's something that's still yet to come. I haven't seen that, the kind of widespread salvation of the Jews that I think Paul envisions, and I expect something like this to be still happening in our future. What do we do in the meantime? We continue to spread the gospel to all. We continue to have a love for all, including God's people that are, historically, people who are the Jewish nation, and we tend to say, we will bring this message of the gospel to them, and it will come a moment, someday, when there will be a widespread turning to Him. These are all things about how the gospel fits together for all people. And then we come to chapter 12, and chapter 12 begins with the words, therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy. In other words, you were all disobedient. Every one of you were disobedient to God, and He poured out His mercy on you. Is this true?
Yes.
He says, in light of that mercy he poured out on you, then we will do this. And chapters 12 and 13 and 14 and 15 and 16, the last chapters of this Bible, or this of this book, the remaining chapters, are ones that says, since God has poured out his mercy on you, here's what we're going to do in response. These are the ways that we're going to respond to God and act toward him in response to that. And there's a lot of very, very powerful and practical things that lie ahead for us here in the rest of the book of Romans. I wonder if all of you would stand.